This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
It's Golden Sense in full flight for the wire over Flashback, and Golden Sense have won the Santa Anita Derby.
Is surging, and it's a photo finish. It's too close to call.
And Animal Kingdom wins the Dubai World Cup.
Mucho Benjamin!
Broadcasting live from the Capital OTB studios, this is Racing Across America with Seth Merrow.
Welcome to this morning's edition of Racing Across America, Thursday morning edition of the show. I'm Seth Merrow. Thanks for joining us. Coming up a little later on, John DeSilva, racingwithbruno.com. We'll talk a little bit about last weekend's races, get some of his opinions, particularly on the Wood Memorial, because John was on the show last Thursday and liked Wicked Strong, the upset winner of the Wood Memorial. We'll also get some of his thoughts on the upcoming action this weekend, stakes-wise, plus some thoughts on racing this afternoon. A little bit later, Dave Rodman from Pimlico. They had some nice stakes action there last Saturday, in particular Ben's Cat. We'll take a look at some of those stakes and get some thoughts on Pimlico's action for this afternoon as well. And then we'll wind things up our last visit of the season with Frank Miramati as Oaklawn Park is wrapping up their winter season this weekend, with, of course, the culmination being the Arkansas Derby. We'll talk a little of that weekend stakes action with Frank and kind of recap the Oaklawn meet as well. All of that coming up on a big edition of Racing Across America, as it is another big stakes weekend coming up. Did note yesterday the very unfortunate news that Steve Crist suffered a cardiac event over the weekend, described his cardiac arrest at his home on Sunday. It's been reported he was at the track at Aqueduct for Wood Memorial Day on Saturday. After having this cardiac issue on Sunday at home, was in the hospital and originally was listed as critical but stable. There was an update put on the Daily Racing Forum website last evening at about 5 o'clock. It's essentially pretty much the same, remains stable but critical after having that cardiac arrest situation over the weekend. So again, our continued good thoughts go out to Steve Crist. We're all wishing the best for him. I noted on Twitter when the news came out a couple of days ago, there was an outpouring of social media comments from fans and horse people and industry types alike wishing the best for Steve Crist, because certainly he is a guy, a very astute observer of the racing industry, and we wish only the best for him when he gets back and behind the typewriter or the computer keyboard as soon as possible. But that is the latest update, pretty much, as I say, still the same. Unfortunate news also coming out of New York, Joe Aquilino. You heard Jeff Carl on the Handicapper Report mention this. Longtime New York trainer Joe Aquilino passes away at age 76. He was battling congestive heart failure for a while, according to the article in the Racing Forum. 76 years old. He was a former New York firefighter. Over his career, over 5,500 starters, 5,500 starters, 477 winners. They earned over $15 million. Joe Aquilino passes away and adds to just a tough little streak for prominent trainers in the Northeast. Of course, it was just recently Dominic Coluccio passed away, and Dickie Small also passed away. So certainly a couple in New York and Dickie Small down in Maryland over the past, not more than 2 weeks, week and a half or so. Tough little streak there. But again, our condolences out to the Aquilino family on his passing. Better news. Now let's get to the horse racing side of things, although whether this is better news or not maybe depends on if you have a future wager down or whatnot. But Albano has been withdrawn from consideration for the Kentucky Derby from Brereton Jones. Albano was the horse that was racing down at Fairgrounds this winter season. Put together an okay campaign, and this is the sibling to Mark Valesky. And if you remember, it wasn't more than probably a couple of seasons ago that Mark Valesky early on was an interesting three-year-old also. So there was certainly some bloodlines there, and the horse had shown some talent on the racetrack. But Brereton Jones said he's a May colt, so he's getting better all the time. But they just kind of looking at the efforts down at Fairgrounds, they decided Kentucky Derby wouldn't be in his plans. Albano will be based at Delaware Park this summer. So we'll see what happens there. Notable, though, Albano now being pulled from consideration from the Kentucky Derby. Notable because he was number 15 on the Derby points leaderboard. And that's notable because number 16 was Candy Boy. Number 17 was Cairo Prince. And again, they're kind of bubble horses with the Bluegrass and the Arkansas Derby coming up. If, you know, four or five leapfrog them, they then move down the list to where they're really sitting on the edge. But I said it a few days ago. I just looking at what happened last year with number 32 at this point on the calendar, eventually making it into the starting gate, I think there'll be some additional defections. And I think Candy Boy and Cairo Prince probably both will make it in. I think Social Inclusion, currently at number 22, although with Albano, let me change that, currently at 21. I think Social Inclusion stands a good chance of making it. We've talked a couple of times with guests this week on the show. Maybe the best thing for Social Inclusion would be if he didn't make it in. The Pimlico may be a better option. The Preakness may be a better option for him in that he's just lightly raced, and maybe a little more seasoning, a little more time would be better for Social Inclusion. But with his connections, if they, points-wise, if it works out, he'll probably wind up in the starting gate. And that becomes a story in the pace scenario. So we'll see how that shakes out. I think Social Inclusion probably will get in. As I say now, with Albano stepping out, Social Inclusion moves up one to 21. Candy Boy, Cairo Prince move up to 15 and 16 on the list because Albano had been number 15. But Albano now withdrawn from consideration for the Kentucky Derby. Story we talked about a little bit over the past couple of weeks since the closing of Fairgrounds. Certainly the Fairgrounds meet was disappointing this year. They had weather issues, but boy, the turf course was just a situation that it seemed to transcend the weather. It seemed like maybe there are some more issues with that turf course, which had a revamp within the past couple of seasons. But, there was certainly some rough patches for the Fairgrounds this past winter season. Subsequently, the meet ended. It was noted that horsemen were kind of pushing back at Churchill Downs and saying they weren't putting enough effort and resources into the Fairgrounds. Then within the past week and a half, some politics became involved as well. And there was a story just within the past 24 hours on the NOLA.com website, which is the website of the Times-Picayune newspaper. It does note that there has now been a bill introduced that would, essentially, it would require Churchill Downs, the owner of the Fairgrounds, to reinvest 10% of the net slot machine proceeds back into the racetrack. There was a hearing, and I'm just trying, Wednesday morning at the state capitol down there, where the state representative presented this bill. It advanced to the Louisiana House floor with no objections, but there was comments on both sides from horsemen and Churchill Downs as well. And again, you can pick up this article at the Times-Picayune website, but Vice President for Churchill Downs said racing is in the midst of a depression. He cited that the fall crop was down 33% since 2008. Then he's quoted again as saying, "We will be dealing with this problem of not enough horses and too many races for the next 3 years. There's nothing I, Churchill Downs Incorporated, or Louisiana can do about that. We need to focus not on emotional issues of tote boards and video screens and what foods are available at different concession stands, but a paradigm shift." And I'm not quite sure that's... I'm not quite sure in this kind of situation, given the meet they had, that's what you wanted to hear. I'm sure that's what the horsemen didn't want to hear from the representative of the track owner. And subsequently, the article then quotes some horse people as well, and it's quite clear that they are clashing down there. So as noted a couple of weeks ago, this story will kind of play out with Fairgrounds meet this winter that, again, had some disappointments and some pushback against Churchill Downs, the track owner. Now the legislature becoming involved. So, again, it will be interesting to see. I'm sure it'll play out over the next few months, and something will be done one way or the other, I would think, before the next Fairground meet opens in November, but we'll keep our eyes on that. This was kind of interesting. Richard Hughes, champion jockey in Great Britain last season for the second consecutive year. He also became the first jockey to ride more than 200 winners in a British flat season last year since Kieran Fallon had done it in 2003. But Richard Hughes in Dubai had a fall in the Shima Classic back on March 29th. And he's quoted as saying, I thought it was just a little bit sore. Well, he wound up going for an X-ray and had a broken back, had a fractured vertebrae. It just shows you these jockeys, tough guys. He was just going to plan to continue riding and thought he had a sore back, and it's actually a broken back. Interesting, though, they said he would be out for 3 months. He's coming back on April 25th. He said, I came back here, went to see a specialist. I was hoping to ride this weekend, but he said, if you take a chance and have a fall, you won't be walking back in here. So he said, I took his advice, and I'll take an extra couple of weeks. Extra couple of weeks? But Richard Hughes, again, broken back, fractured vertebrae, but he plans to be back fairly quickly. Essentially, they were talking 3 months initially. This would be the fall was March 29th. He's talking about coming back on the 25th, also in less than a month. And again, I think it's the same for the jockeys over there as it is over here. A lot of these guys come back a little too quickly. We'll keep our eyes on Richard Hughes, champion jockey, and I'm sure he doesn't want to miss too many days and have a chance at a third consecutive title, but you don't want to come back too soon and then really screw things up. So we'll see how that plays out as well. Keep our eyes over there. All right, we'll take our first break. When we come back, John DeSilva, racingwithbruno.com. As I said, take a look at some of the action from last weekend and get his thoughts. Action for today, and we'll look forward to this weekend as well. Stay tuned. All of that when Racing Across America continues.
Missed one of our TV shows? No worries. Now you can catch all your favorite programs online. Simply log on to CapitalOTV.com and click on the YouTube link at the bottom of the homepage. And look for our new podcast coming soon. CapitalOTV.com. Log on today.
The Capital OTV Handicapping Challenge Series is back. That's right. The 2014 Capital OTV Handicapping Challenge Series is back, and it's your chance to win thousands in cash and prizes and a seat at the 2015 Handicapping Championship in Las Vegas. This month's contest is the Triple Threat on May 10th. So sign up today online at CapitalOTV.com or stop in at the Clubhouse Racebook.
The future of online betting is here, and only at the all-new CapitalOTVBet.com. With a newly designed and engineered internet wagering platform, enhanced video streaming, additional funding options, and three new individual wagering opportunities, CapitalOTVBet.com delivers a state-of-the-art wagering experience found nowhere else in horse racing. Combine that with our all-new mobile website. You have two of the most powerful, innovative, and advanced wagering platforms available today. CapitalOTVBet.com. Log on today.
It's called the fastest 2 minutes in sports, and the tradition continues Saturday, May 3rd, with the 140th running of the Kentucky Derby. If you can't make it to the Clubhouse Racebook in Albany, you can still be a part of the action by visiting one of our many Easy Bet or branch locations conveniently located throughout upstate New York. For a complete list of our Easy Bet and branch locations, log on to CapitalOTV.com. Capital OTV and CapitalOTVBet.com. The most convenient ways to wager on all the Triple Crown races.
I'm Anthony Mormino. Join me weekdays at 9 for the Handicappers Report. We'll handicap the top tracks across the country and help you prepare for the day in racing. That's the Handicappers Report, weekdays at 9, only on the OTV TV network.
Welcome back to Racing Across America. Thursday morning means a regular visit from John DeSilva of RacingWithBruno.com. You can find John's selections at RacingWithBruno.com. Good morning, John.
Good morning. How's everything?
Very good. Happy to have you on board. And I mentioned at the top of the show, John, and being a New York-based guy, I want to see if you have any comments. The unfortunate news that Joe Aquilino had passed away. Really a tough couple of weeks for the training community in the Northeast. You toss in Dominic Lucio and Dickie Small. But again, being a New York-based guy, I wonder if you had any thoughts on Joe Aquilino.
You want to talk about one of the nicest guys you'd ever want to meet at the racetrack? Joe Aquilino is that he always helped out people, gave them opportunities whenever they needed. I mean, my friend Kevin Cox, the handicapper who's on Horse Players, he told on Facebook how when he needed a job, you know, he didn't know what he was doing. Joe went out there, gave his first job as a hot walker. You know, so he would come out from being a mounted cop. He'd go out there to the backstretch and work with horses, and Joe helped him out a lot. I mean, that was just the type of guy Joe is. Always friendly, always willing to give a helping hand, and always treats his horses the right way. And he's been in failing health the past few years, but we were all rooting for him. We all wanted to see him come back, and it's a tremendous loss for us.
Yeah, really unfortunate. And as I say, it's been a tough week and a half, couple of weeks in the training community. All right, let's shift our attention to happier thoughts, see if we can hand out some winners for this afternoon. You've got the early pick three at Aqueduct. You'll give some thoughts there. After that, we're going to take a look back at last week when you gave us a very nice win in the Wood Memorial, and look forward also to this weekend, get some of your thoughts on the two big three-year-old stakes that are coming up. But let's kick off with this afternoon. The opener is a New York-bred maiden claimer, 16 tags, three-year-olds and up, going seven.
Well, you know, we have a 6-5 favorite here in Linda Rice's Kicking Butt, who ran second last time out, drops to 16. But at 6-5, we need to find something a little different. Looking at the past performances, we see a few changes, a few trainer changes. But in a situation like this, let's go with the stranger. Let's go with the first-time starter, number 3, Marlon's Wonder. Now, Nick Gessler, I've been impressed with the job he's done since he's been on his own as a trainer. Marlon picks up Maddie at this horse has been working steadily. And looking at this competition, to me, the only horse you really have to beat that worries me is going to be Kicking Butt. And I think Marlon's Wonder just might be good enough to do that.
Yeah, and Essler is a guy who's catching a little bit of fire, getting a little bit of buzz, it seems like.
He deserves an opportunity. I mean, I was hoping he was somebody that Zayat would have looked at when they're looking for new trainers right now because, again, Esther has impressed me. He has a nice background. People do not realize that he was an assistant trainer for many years for Keneally and a couple of other people. He knows what he's doing. He just needs an opportunity, and I'm hoping he gets it now.
Yeah, and when you put up numbers like he is, it seems like that could be around the corner. So if he's a good guy, we'll root for him as well. Second race at Aqueduct this afternoon, 12-5 claimer for fillies and mares, four-year-olds and up. Again, they're going to go 7 furlongs.
Yeah, you got to like the 7-furlong event, and a lot of people are going to look at Quiet Sunshine, but again, David Jacobs enjoying the way, but he can't win everything. I mean, he has to beat them every once in a while. So I'm going to try to beat them here, and, you know, taking chances, knowing what people are going to look at, but I'm going to try to beat it. I'm going to go with Caitlin's Cat. I mean, this is a horse of one, a non-winner for 3 for 16,000, drops to 12.5 today. Stretches out. I think that's the right running style to do it for Laura Perillo, another young trainer who has done pretty well, you know, since taking over the New York operations for Midwest Thoroughbreds. And so I'll give Caitlin's Cat, who might turn out to be an overlay if the other two horses do get bet, which I expect it to be.
Yeah, and there's a perfect example of a trainer getting tied up with a pretty good outfit, and that makes all the difference. You get tied in with Midwest Thoroughbreds, you're definitely going to put some wins on the resume. Third race this afternoon, maiden claimer, $25,000 tags. Fillies and mares, three-year-olds, and up this time, the one-turn mile.
Yeah, the one-turn mile, and again, we're going to try to beat the favorite here. Hope to get a little lucky. I mean, Sunday school, 0-12. You could keep the 0-12. You could only go so much there. So I'm going to go with number 3, Wild Faith. I mean, this is a horse who ran third for $35,000, going a mile 16th. Cuts back to the one-turn mile today. It's lucky retained. The mile drops from 35 to 25. I mean, to me, I think it's no one with a right type of running style. There isn't much speed in the race. I think Roy Matilda probably sets the pace today, and they're trying to take him as far as they can, but I just think in the end, Wild Faith will be able to run that one down and then hold off of Sunday school for the victory.
Very good. So there are some thoughts on today's early pick three at Aqueduct, and again, as noted, John, you gave out some good advice last week, and we'll mention that as we kick off a little recap of last week's stakes action to get some of your thoughts, particularly on the two big three-year-old stakes last weekend. We'll first up go to the Wood Memorial, because when we had you in last Thursday, you pointed right to Wicked Strong. You thought this horse would be well prepped by Jimmy Jerkins, tossed in a couple of disappointing efforts down at Gulfstream, but you said if anybody can get him back and ready for a spot like this and have him prepped, Jimmy Jerkins would be the one. And as the son of Alan Jerkins, adds another fun human interest story to the Derby Trail. We're going to watch the stretch run here, John, of the Wood Memorial. It will be Wicked Strong getting up at 9-1, so he gave us a nice $20 winner there. Sam Rott just gets up in the photo over social inclusion. What were your thoughts coming out of the Wood Memorial?
Well, tremendous job by Jimmy to get this horse ready. I mean, this is a horse, maybe he didn't like Florida, but at the same time, I don't know if Florida likes this horse, because the key was, look at that race against Constitution. Even though he was badly beaten fourth, he ran against the bias that day, and these are things we had to pick up. When you have a super speedway like he ran on Fountain of Youth Day, and you see a horse that's able to make up ground despite a bias like that, definitely pay attention next time out. Hey, look at Drosselmeyer, Jockey Club Gold Cup Day, super speedway. Next time out, he wins the Breeders' Cup Classic. That's where you get your prices, where you pay attention to biases. And hey, you hear Sterling talk about it all the time. Take advantage of horses that ran well against the bias and bet them next time out, as long as they get that fair racetrack. I mean, Rajiv gave him a tremendous ride, did a very nice job there, and I'll be very curious to see what type of support this horse gets coming into the Kentucky Derby, because with the background of Centennial, with what happened with the Boston Marathon, how this horse was named, he's going to get a lot of buzz. And usually horses like that do get that. So we have to pay a lot of attention. And how expensive of a nose was it for second and third?
Yeah.
I mean, nobody's offering $8 million for that horse now, and they wanted 15.
I said earlier, you know, he was sitting at 22 on the leaderboard. With the Albano now stepping out, he's 21. I think he might get in, but we've talked to some guests this week who said, you know, the best thing maybe if he's excluded, and points to the Preakness. And I wouldn't argue with that, being such as lightly raced as he is.
It's a possibility, but we have to remember we have 8 more spots to be filled with points this week. And you take a horse, for example, like Rylan Curlin, even by finishing third or fourth, you'll pass him. And it'll knock him back. And we have other horses who could knock him back. I mean, I was looking at the race this weekend, which we'll talk about in a second. And I think there's a couple of horses there who have the possibility of getting points to knock him back even more. So he needs experience. You know, I think the owner has visions of grandeur, which he has to realize, hey, the horse is good, but he ain't that good. I'm to say that this horse is never going to get beat again. You got a jockey who said he was facing with stuff that he just couldn't handle at the end. They're obviously not on the same page.
Yeah, and it will be interesting to see if he does get into the Derby. The interesting thing there is he adds to that pace scenario. So maybe even as a better, maybe we hope he goes to the sidelines. But we'll see how that shakes out. Give us some thoughts also. On the weekend, to me, more definition was given to the Derby Trail with the Santa Anita Derby with California Chrome. I mean, that was totally impressive. And again, adds a really nice human interest story to the Derby Trail as well with Art Sherman.
Oh, he was tremendous. I mean, this is a horse who people have to realize he's not a front runner, but because of the way the race sets up, he was able to be that close to pace. He's a very versatile horse, and you want that going into the Kentucky Derby, because you do have a lot of speed into this race, and this is a horse who has shown the ability to come from off the pace, and I think California Chrome is a deserving favorite. I know one guy on television was saying 2-1. That's not going to happen, because of Toy Horse Fuel especially. But if I see him going off as a 4-1 morning line favorite, I can see that.
Yeah, 2-1. You're not. Yeah, that's somebody who is not thinking 20 horse field, because you just don't see that unless a horse is a crazy favorite. Even that is with 20 horses, 2-1 would be an incredibly short price. But currently, as you say, it's not going to shock me at all, 4-1, and he's at the top of all the pundits' lists. I think of something, you know, Tapicher ran huge this weekend. I think he could potentially vie for favoritism, but currently right now it does look like California Chrome. And speaking of this weekend, John, let's get some thoughts on the two big three-year-old Derby preps. First up, let's talk about the Bluegrass, $750,000. It's on the synthetic surface for the last time, a grade one event, 9 furlongs. And John, while we talk, going to pull up the allowance event back on March 8th on the turf down at Tampa. We're going to watch the number one, Bobby's Kitten, get it done for Chad Brown and Ken and Sarah Ramsey. This was the three-year-old debut for Bobby's Kitten, was coming out of a third-place finish in the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Turf. And in fact, Bobby's Kitten, only been on the turf in 5 starts in his career. Moves over to the synthetics on Saturday. But even a win there leaves a lot of question marks if they go to the Derby. And with Ken Ramsey, you know they will. But Bobby's Kitten's kind of interesting. Extra sexy hipster for Mike Trombetta. Vince Ramos I find interesting. And maybe most interesting of all, medal count on the quick turnaround for Dale Romans. What are your thoughts on the Bluegrass?
Despite what Joe Drape says, the synthetics did not help this race getting horses getting ready for the Kentucky Derby. And I think one of the reasons they're switching, because I think they probably realize that they're on the precipice of losing their grade one status. So that being said, you look at this race, I think it's going to set for horses who are synthetics or turf runners. 3 horses intrigue me. We have Pablo Damonte, who is 2-for-2 at Keeneland, has been working very well at Keeneland coming into this race. And the one thing you have to remember with a horse like this, that he began his career, he was training at Keeneland, did very well. Once he gets away from training over surface like that and running on dirt, he hasn't done well. But he seems like a different horse training on the synthetic. You have to pay attention. And the same thing with Big Bazinga. And this is a horse who a lot of people thought would run very well in Spiral, but the horse was based down in Florida. Now, last year, the horse ran in Woodbine, ran well, but running on the dirt and training on the dirt down in Palmetto is not the same. After Spiral goes back to Keeneland, look at that work in April 6th. That horse seems to have wakened up. And again, training on the synthetic coming into this race has gotten this horse to wake up, and at the price you had to pay attention to Big Bazinga. And then your top Fletcher Gallant Award has never run on dirt, but is 2-for-3 with a second. They won the Palm Beach last time out, and despite the post outside post position, again, it's a grass horse who I think is bred to run on the dirt, so should handle synthetic. Bernardine, you have a Carson City mare, and you got Johnny Riding, so Gallant Award you have to pay attention to.
Very good. And so there are three interesting thoughts on the Bluegrass. Let's shift our attention now over to Oaklawn on Saturday, the Grade 1 Arkansas Derby for $1 million, a mile and an eighth. I'm waiting for Tapicher to come back to that race in the Southwest, and I'm hoping he'll be an interesting horse moving forward to the Kentucky Derby. Adds maybe a not-so-attractive human interest story, certainly from the mainstream media side of things. But besides Tapicher, you have Commissioner for Todd Pletcher. Conquest Titan, I think, is better than we saw in that last effort in the Tampa Derby. I'm looking for a rebound from him. Question marks, obviously, with Bayern, but 2-for-2 and pretty convincing 2-for-2 for Bob Baffert, and, of course, strong mandate for Wayne Lucas. What are your thoughts in the Arkansas Derby?
Well, no matter what happens, because of Vast Muscle Known, there will be people who be rooting against Tapicher, so there's no chance he could even compete for favoritism in the Derby, even if he runs this weekend. And I don't care what Steve DeVivitt says, Steve Vast Muscle, if he earned the right to run a horse in there, horse should go no matter what, because until you're convicted of something, you can't penalize a guy. So Tapicher has an excellent chance of winning, even though I am going to take 2 shots against him. Conquest Titan, I like the move to Burrell. I mean, this is a horse who I think has all the ability in the world. Tampa is not an easy track to race at. And I think this is a horse who we know likes Churchill Downs, could be improving at the right time. I mean, look at that work at Churchill Downs on April 7th. That tells you what he thinks right then and there. So Conquest Titan, you have to pay attention to. And even Ryan Curlin, I think, with a change of jockey, should get a better trip here. I think could be very dangerous.
I think this is going to be a fun race. And again, on the synthetics, I'm not sure what we're going to see come out of the bluegrass, but the Arkansas Derby, certainly to me, very, very interesting. All right, John, as always, we appreciate the visit. Good luck this afternoon and on the weekend. We'll talk to you again next week.
You got it. Take care.
John DeSilva from RacingWithBruno.com. We'll take our next break and head down to Pimlico. Dave Rodman right after this.
The future of online betting is here, and only at the all-new CapitalOTBBet.com. CapitalOTBBet.com delivers a state-of-the-art wagering experience found nowhere else in horse racing. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
Fascinated by the world of horse racing? Interested in honing your handicapping skills? Class is in session. Night school, Monday nights. Easy to access online. It's free, interactive, and informative. For the casual and serious race fan. Horse Player Now Buzz. Live horses to watch, emailed to you daily. Our eyes, your prize. Night School and the Buzz. Visit horseplayernow.com for details.
Each morning on the OTB TV network, you get the very best in horse racing programming. Weekdays begin with the Handicappers Report, where professional handicappers share their selections and analysis of the day's racing. Followed by Racing Across America, a daily conversation with racing personalities from around the country. Saturdays include Down the Stretch, where Mark Cassano speaks with the biggest names in racing. And Sunday mornings, it's Loose on the Lead, where Steve Bick and I offer news and a unique lineup of weekly guests. All here on the OTB TV network.
Funding your Capital OTB bet account is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1, easy money. Clearly the fastest and easiest method of depositing funds into your account. Make deposits or withdrawals in just minutes. 2, Green Dot Money Pack gives you instant access to your funds. Green Dot Money Packs are available at thousands of retailers nationwide. And 3, MasterCard Visa. Simply click on the link from the funding page, enter your account information, and fund your account. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
It's called the fastest 2 minutes in sports, and the tradition continues Saturday, May 3rd, with the 140th running of the Kentucky Derby. And there's only one place to watch it, the Clubhouse Racebook. To be a part of the excitement, reserve your seat today by calling 446-4010.
Welcome back. Happy to be joined now by Dave Rodman from Pimlico. Good morning, Dave.
Good morning. It feels like Pimlico. It feels like spring, finally.
Yeah, We're scheduled to hit mid-60s up here today, but that's going to be about a 30-degree difference from when I hopped in my car. It was not warm this morning, but we're looking forward to some springtime temperatures. It's getting there. Slowly but surely, it's getting there. Give us an overall view. What's the weather going to be like this afternoon?
About the same here. It's in the 50s now and going to be in the 60s. Nice blue skies. We had quite a bit of rain on the off days, Sunday, Monday. And I said, well, this turf course is going to be soaked and no chance, and they'll probably be out. But we had a lot of sunshine the last couple of days, so it's just nice and dried out, I think. Maybe not exactly firm, was on the good side last week, so we'll go fast and good for now.
All right, and we'll take a look at a few races for this afternoon, and then I want to go back and look at some of the stakes action on the weekend because, of course, Ben's cat was back in. We always want to talk about him. But first up this afternoon, fifth race today, scheduled 5 furlongs on the turf, conditional claimer, 20 to 25 tags, non-winners of 2 lifetime. They're going to go, as I say, 5 furlongs on the grass.
Yeah, I'm going to take a little chance here with a horse who's beaten 18 lengths in her last start, making a turf debut for trainer Dale Capuano, Eric Rodriguez riding. That jockey-trainer combination, first time on the turf, 5 for 20 together. So kind of maybe a go-to rider for turf horses for Dale. A dam of this horse, Believe in Wonder, is by Aldebaran, who was, did okay on the turf. And the broodmare sire-wise looks good. Has yet to repeat that big race at Laurel in early December. But she's had a couple of excuses in her last two. I don't know about the third race back when she was beaten 20 cents to a dollar. I'm hoping the turf can wake her up back to her big number for maiden special weight, best number perhaps in the field.
And I'm looking at the morning line, and I got to think that's going to float up a little bit. It's 9-2, and off of those past couple of races, the last one right at this condition, seems like that 9-2 is a little short.
Well, they do play Dale here in Maryland.
That
was Keith's way of thinking there. And otherwise, it's not a super strong field. You got Smart and Smoking coming off the layoff. Interesting horses other than that. M's Punch maybe with some speed to try to go all the way. The because it's only 5/8. And Hypatia's Sky is an interesting mare. They scratched her for 8, and then they ran her back for 8. But I think they were kind of toying with people there after that long layoff. Nobody took her, and here she is for 25, and again, a not-for-love mare. She's got some interesting just-off-the-pace style here. Kind of an interesting kind of a price. So I went 4913, just in case anybody's interested in using a few other horses.
All right, sounds good. Let's shift our attention now out to race number 7 this afternoon. That's an allowance, non-winners of one other than 3-year-olds and up. Get on the grass at 5.
Love this race, Seth. 8367 of the 4 picks in here. But I really think, you know, it's a great race to box, say, 3 or 4 horses. Number 8, Make My Saturday, is going to be the top pick off for 300-plus days for trainer Tim Tulloch. The dam of this horse, Exciting Justice, won her only start on the turf. Sprinting at Ellis Park, paid 8-1 when she did win, then came back to win next out Turfway Park on the synthetic there, a little overnight stake. Time away is a concern, but she's pretty quick early if she's right. You see, look at those early fractions on the dirt. And I thought she was going to be okay last year. We bet on her. I bet out on her at Penn National that night in a race that came off the turf. They tried to get her on the turf last year, and she's been off ever since. But trainer Tim Tulloch, good with this kind of layoff. Well, he got Gattopardo to win off an almost 1,000-day layoff. I'm going to take my chances here on a gelding that has a good amount of early speed. I think you'll get your money's worth for it, hopefully, the whole 5 furlongs, but I think he'll be up top at some stage in the race here.
Yeah, and I call plays of the day here a lot on the handicapping show, and sometimes it's worth reiterating. I'll go 4 deep a lot of times, and I think some people think, that is folly. But if you have an 8-1 shot, you know, you got to look up at the board and see if it makes sense. Yeah. But an 8-1 shot can give you enough value.
Let me give you an example. The Jackpot Pick 5, which is now a 10-cent wager, offering $50,000 guaranteed and a trip to the Preakness via a single ticket. This past Sunday, if you went 3 by 3 by 3 by 3 by 3, you can do that ticket for very, very cheap. And it paid at $2,500, mostly due to a DQ of a favorite. Big price got put up, and I look back at the picks, you know, had all of the winners in the top selection. With a dime wager, you can go deep.
Yeah.
You know, you can go 3 by 3 by 2 by 2. You can use multiple horses. I mean, for a dime, $2,500, nothing to sneeze at. So you're right. Going 3, especially in this kind of field, you can go 3-4 deep in here.
Yeah, and that's what has attracted me to that Rainbow 6 down at Gulfstream. It's a 20-cent wager, but you can kind of spread a little bit, and you're playing what the whales are normally playing at $2, and it's the same thing, as you say, your pick 5 wager down there, which has a very small increment, and that guaranteed $50,000 pot as well makes it
attractive. It almost went a couple of times last week. They almost had to pay out into it. You know, the pool, the carryover smaller than the 50K guarantees we started to meet. But, the fans, it almost got it a couple of times last week.
All right, let's shift out one more race for this afternoon. A maiden claimer, 20 to 25 tags, again on the grass, going 1 mile in the 9th.
Tiara Gold going to be the pick in this spot. I think you'll love the stretch out by Tiago, Santa Anita Derby, Oakland Handicap, Goodwood winner. Adam had a couple of wins to her credit, both on the synthetic. So I think this horse should like the turf, given the long pedigree up top and possible maybe synthetic liking on the bottom, which could equate to turf. A filly that looked great in the track at Laurel, looked like $1 million. She would have gone right to the windows if you'd seen her. And she broke a bit slow down in the dead rail, came up a little empty, and flattened out last time up against a horse named Antietam Creek, who will be running here Saturday. She's a pretty speedy type, set good fractions there. She's dropping. I think she'll be very close to the pace today. I don't want to say wire to wire, but this stretch out, she'll be in a new world today, going the mile on the turf, Tiara Gold.
With the potent maiden special weight to maiden claiming movie, always
yes,
like that.
And the drop in class, right.
All right, before we let you go, just wanted to go back to last weekend and take a look. A nice stakes card there, highlighted by what we're going to take a look at first, the Mr. Diz. $75,000, 5 furlongs on the turf, and it was the seasonal debut of one of our favorites, now 8 years old, Ben's Cat, and came into this race with $1.8 million. He is approaching that $2 million mark. Goes out for the venerable King Leatherberry, 1-5 on the morning line, 1-5 as they went off. The number three, Ben's Cat, got it done in the Mr. Diz.
Yeah, won the war of mass destruction, didn't want any part of him. He scratched. I was kind of disappointed in that a little bit. They could have at least run second, I thought. But Ben's Cat found a much easier spot with those two out. And you've just got to admire this horse. Year after year, he's consistent. And King Leatherberry at the age of 81 got him going good. It's given him, as we've mentioned many times on the show, the money to claim and keep that stable going, the Jim stable, the last couple of years. He's just been a horse that's become a fan favorite here, headed to the Jim McKay turf sprint during Preakness Week is the ultimate goal for him. But you could tell throughout he was just kind of toying with the field.
He is just so much fun.
And the fifth time he's won this race, Mr. Diz, 5 years in a row.
That's incredible.
I mean, look through the record book, Spider Horse has done that. Same stake, 5 years running.
That is incredible. All right, next up, it's the Twixt. We're going to see Aunt Ellen win. I'm guessing she's not going to win this 5 years in a row because she was pretty lucky to get it done this year. Aunt Ellen, Horacio Caramanos on board Ferris Allen Trains, went off as the rank outsider at 18-1. Why did it go off as the rank outsider? 10 starts so far, no wins. This was a maiden and gets up there with a nice late run. We'll watch the number five, Aunt Ellen, win the Twixt on the weekend, again, paying $39. This was a surprise.
Yeah, maiden breaking win in the stakes race. Ferris had a couple of them here. Of course, it was more highly regarded down on the inside. First off, the claim was seemed to flatten out. Slow and steady. I don't want to say I will say it. I thought she was vulnerable going in. I just didn't have the right horse to beat her because her last race at Laurel was a bit of a decline for her, I thought, both visually and numbers-wise. I just couldn't figure the maiden doing it. I've always liked this filly, no doubt about it. I told a couple of people I liked her, but Caramanos just sat back, sat chilly, and when Slow and Steady opened up, he came running with something left. It wasn't a real visually impressive race, but the greatest quote of all was after the race, trainer Ferris Allen said, "Now do you think she can win Nylanders at two?" You know, thinking like, she's good, but I wonder if, you know, she'll probably obviously be favored in Nylanders at two. And it would be something else if she did not win Nylanders at two coming off the stakes win.
Yeah, coming off the stakes win and having trouble in the N2X. Yeah, interesting.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you know, you read the chart there, and you think that maybe there was a, you know, possibly Slow and Steady could have dug in a little bit more. I don't want to go into that, but I don't know. I've liked her. As a matter of fact, I told a couple of people, you know, for 25, she might be worth claiming, but nobody. I guess that's the way it goes.
Now they're all kicking themselves. All right, let's take a look at the Dahlia, which wrapped up the stakes card on Saturday at Pimlico. $100,000 mile on the turf for three-year-old and up fillies and mares. It'll be won by M-Bar. Graham Motion had a couple coming off a layoff. M-Bar herself was coming off a layoff, had run most recently in the November Cardinal down at Churchill Downs. This was a horse that has been facing some nice graded stakes company in her career, and M-Bar comes down the stretch as the number three horse and gets it done under Forrest Bryce.
Yeah, well, I guess M-Bar realized Ben's Cat won the same stakes 5 years running. This is the second straight year for her to win the Dahlia. And trainer, this who could have got it redder after a long time away. So this is a horse who runs fresh, runs well, likes this course. Arguably, the Grand Motion horse was a little bit of trouble, I thought, in between, and kind of a backed-up kind of a pace and a short field. And got out a little bit too late. I think we mentioned on the show, I really loved her last week. And I think this sets her up. I can't remember the name of the horse now. I don't have it in front of me. The Grand Motion horse that ran third in the race.
Was it Zucchini Flower or Joy?
Flower. I knew it was a flower. Zucchini Flower. I think she is certainly one to watch. And, you know, with a clear pace next time in front of her, a better pace, and a clear trip, she'll come rolling late to redeem herself. So I think these two will hook up, actually. again in Stakes Company. But next time I might take Zucchini Flower. She was kind of in between horses early. But I don't want to take anything away from a great training job there and the fact that Embar likes this course. VA bred, of all things, right? So I guess you won't find too many Virginia bred races at Colonial this summer, the way things are going.
Ouch. Yeah. And you're right, though, on the horse for the course angle. She's now 4 for 5 over that track.
So that was an excellent race. So, you know, and I realized Ben's cat didn't beat a whole lot, but it was good to see the cat win again and maybe set him up for better things pretty quick.
Yeah, fun opening weekend down at Pimlico. Dave, absolutely appreciate the visit, as always. Good luck this afternoon with the selections. We'll talk to you next week.
Okay, talk to you later, Seth.
Thanks a lot. Dave Rodman from Pimlico. We'll take our last break. When we come back, we'll head down to Oaklawn, closing weekend, Festival of the South. We'll talk some stakes action with Frank Miramonte right after this.
I'm Jeff Carl. Join me Saturdays and Sundays at 9 for the Handicappers Report. We'll handicap the top tracks across the country and help you prepare for the weekend in racing. That's the Handicappers Report, weekends at 9, only here on the OTB TV network.
Called the fastest 2 minutes in sports, and the tradition continues Saturday, May 3rd, with the 140th running of the Kentucky Derby. If you can't make it to the Clubhouse Racebook in Albany, you can still be a part of the action by visiting one of our many Easy Bet or branch locations conveniently located throughout upstate New York. For a complete list of our Easy Bet and branch locations, log on to CapitalOTB.com. Capital OTB and CapitalOTBBet.com. The most convenient ways to wager on all the Triple Crown races.
I got it. Watch me. I got it. Hey! I got something that makes me want to shout. I got something that tells me what it's all about. I got a move that tells me what to do. If you don't, brothers and sisters, then you won't know what it's all about.
This is Steve Beck. Join me Tuesday through Saturday here on OTB TV for At the Races, my SiriusXM daily news magazine of the thoroughbred industry. Handicapping, interviews, analysis, everything you could want. 6 a.m. OTB TV.
Welcome back to Racing Across America. Very happy to be joined now by Frank Miramonte from Oaklawn Park, although sad to say it's Frank's last visit of the season. And Frank, not only will we miss you, but I'm going to miss Oaklawn Park. I have had just really enjoyed this meet. I've had a couple of nice scores down there. And yesterday in that next to the last, I think it was the eighth race, how did that horse get away and pay $40? I was all over that horse coming off the nice win. And that's
the funny thing. It was Ivan falling up a lot. The funny thing about that, on the replay show that I do, I told people what a great claim it was, blah, 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 and then I threw him out myself. So it just happened. That's what happened.
And it's just been, the meet has been like that, with horses kind of sneaking in a lot of fun value. And, Frank, obviously it's a big weekend. We'll certainly touch on that in a moment. But speaking of value, you got on the line with me this morning during the break, and you said you were raring to go with a couple for this afternoon to kind of wind up your visits with us. So why don't we get right into it? Look at the 7 today, optional claimer, 50 tags, non-winners of 2 lifetime going 6 furlongs. What were your thoughts in the 7th?
I love the 12 in here. Midnight Angelus is her name. She's by Midnight Loot. I actually watched her debut on TV. And she is a very, very talented filly. I watched it live. My friend is actually a co-owner. The stories I've heard about this for so long and how good she is, I thought she was the next coming of Ruffian. I was glad that at least she won her debut after all the hype I listened to. But she's training unbelievably well, and she's going to be tough to deny. And, you know, you might get a price because she's coming in from Delta. To me, the only horse in the field that has a chance of beating her is the 5 Silk Purse, because Brad Cox is phenomenal. But I really think this is a great play for your audience. Number 12, Midnight Angelus in race 7.
We like it. 4-1 on the morning line. 8th race this afternoon. Condition I've never seen before. It's an optional claiming race. 40 tags, but the condition N1M, non-winners over a mile condition, a little bit strange. This is a one-mile event. Your thoughts in the eighth?
I'm going to number seven, Rhetorical. This horse was claimed back by Chris Hartman. When he ran for Chris on January 19th, that was a giant performance, better than even the 2 3/4 lengths indicate. He was claimed out of that race. He won, and then last time he was nowhere. I really believe that if he took him back, that's all I need to know. And if you look at his race at Prairie Meadows, he finished second twice, going a mile and a mile 70. He's 5-1. I think the horse to beat is right inside of him, back 40. They had entered him in an optional claimer for like 80,000. And I know that one of the assistants told me the reason they scratched is the owner didn't want to lose that horse. I think it's 76 trombones, 7-6 in race 8 today.
I like that, the 76 trombones exact. All right, Frank, before we take a look out at the stakes action on the weekend, a big weekend, closing weekend, just wanted to recap some of the human side of the game. I pulled up the Equibase stats, and I'll get some of your comments. On the jockey side, it's going to be Ricardo Santana. Norberto Arroyo got off to such a great start. He's going to wind up, it looks like, third, although things could shake out. David Mello, who probably a month and a half or so ago started to attract my attention, looks like wind up second. But again, underneath, things could potentially shake out. Ricardo Santana, though, will not be caught. On the trainer side, interesting, Steve Asmussen seemed to get hot there over the past couple of weeks. A couple of win lead over Frederico Villafranco. But Asmussen coming in with all his bullets loaded over the weekend. I think just the numbers are going to put Asmussen in a pretty good spot. Chris Richard will finish third, it potentially looks like. Again, things could potentially shake up over the weekend, but that's where they stand now. And then on the owner's side, I found this interesting. Danny Caldwell, who, as I understand it, is tied in with the Frederico
Villafranco. Yeah, that's the team. That's 1 and 1A together.
Okay. Yeah, he is very likely to be the leading owner. He has a 9-win lead, so I don't see anybody catching him over the weekend.
No, he had a tremendous season.
Over Maggie Moss and Midwest Thoroughbreds, and I had to look it up because I wasn't familiar with Caldwell, but he's a guy who has won some titles over at Remington and seems to have come over now to Oaklawn the past couple of seasons and really put it all together this year, certainly. So give us some of your thoughts on the human side.
Well, first of all, Danny's a great guy. I had a chance to meet him this year, and he's very passionate. They came in with a plan, and I'll tell you what, if you were backing that barn this meet, you cleaned up because they came with some prices. They're amazing off the claim. They're just really solid, and you got to pay attention to them going forward wherever they end up. You know, Prairie Meadows is probably on their agenda. Watch wherever they are in the Midwest. Federico Villafranco's horses have been running lights out. Steve, you're right. Steve Asmussen, he had he's been there right through the whole meet. Usually he comes like a freight train at the end. He had a couple of weeks where he got a little cold, but now he's back on all cylinders. He's here. He's focused, and he'll win some races in the next few days. You know, he's just tremendous. He wins everywhere all the time. David Mello, you're right. He's a nice young man. And he rides well. He rides a lot of those Chris Richard horses, but he rides for other barns. He, too, came in with some serious price horses throughout the meet. There's sometimes people like to bet on connections. Those connections, if you were betting David Mello on meet, if you were betting Federico Villafranco on meet, believe me, you left here with some cash in your pocket. And good for those guys. It's fun to celebrate the successes of people. And it's nice when it's not always the same group on top. You know, it's good to see people that are trying hard. And Federico and Danny Cole have been very aggressive at the claim box. And so I'm sure they're going to have a lot of live horses coming up.
Yeah, as I say, when I pulled up those owner results and saw Caldwell, I wasn't familiar with him and had to go dig out the things. But he's right over Maggie Moss and Midwest Thoroughbred. So it's fun to see a new face in there. All right, Frank, let's take a look at a couple of the real story races for Saturday. First up, the Oaklawn Handicap. And Frank, while we talk, we're going to go back to last year's Rebel Stakes. We're going to watch number 7, Will Take Charge, get it done. Folks may forget that Will Take Charge has a little history over the Oaklawn Strip and seems to like it. Since leaving Oaklawn last year, though, he had that Triple Crown trail that wasn't that productive. But boy, the end of the season certainly was. And there have been a couple of second-place finishes so far, but I think everybody agrees this is a real player in the handicap division now. So we'll take charge. Interesting on Saturday. Revolutionary for Todd Pletcher. Marino, who was right there with Will Take Charge in last year's controversial Travers. It wound up to be a little bit of a controversial story afterwards. He's in there. And Prayer for Relief, now in the barn of Dale Romans, who threw in the big effort in December at the fairgrounds, but subsequently hasn't lived up to that. But I think all eyes, obviously, on Will Take Charge on Saturday.
No question about it. I'll tell you what, to me, the other two horses in this race might be very interesting underneath. But Will Take Charge is a monster. His dam, Take Charge Lady, ran in one of the most, you know, most amazing races ever at Oaklawn, and that was with against Azari in the Apple Blossom, where she just missed. So when Will Take Charge is a gorilla, I don't see him getting beaten here, but it's just going to be fun to be able to watch and call him. Carb is a horse that was gigantic in that allowance win over here. Brad Cox has taken over for him. And Golden Lad, he's got this really weird look. He's got this, like, it looks like a rash, but it's not. It's just some deal on him. It looks like he's almost washing out. I had to look closely at him. Very interesting little thing on his right side. But he ran amazingly well. And the funny thing is, when he was walking to the gate that day, I was thinking to myself, I don't know about this horse. He didn't, you know, he didn't seem to have that look, you know, the eye of the tiger. And then he went out and romped home. I was glad I didn't get to share that opinion with anyone. It was just me watching him walking to the gate. So this is a very, very good race. And, you know, all the top four highweights all showed up. We couldn't be happier with turnout for the Oaklawn Handicap.
And the highlight of the meet, obviously, the Arkansas Derby. $1 million on the line, plus some important Kentucky Derby points. Grade one event going a mile and an eighth. Frank, while we talk, we're going to go back to the Southwest and watch Tapiture win. Tapiture still very interesting to me. Another horse that I have on my top 10 list, I'm a voter in the ESPN poll, Conquest Titan. I think he's better than that Tampa Derby, so I'm looking for a rebound for him. Obviously, there are question marks about Bayern, but when Baffert comes to Oaklawn, you have to pay attention. I don't think people have given up yet on Strong Mandate. Todd Pletcher brings in Commissioner. This is a really fun addition of the Arkansas Derby.
It really is, but I really believe Bayern is going to put on a display for people, and he's going to become a part of everybody's top list for Kentucky Derby horses. This horse is training like a freak, and, you know, Baffert, this looks like Bodemeister Part 2 to me. If I was looking in advance, that's what I'm expecting to see for Bayern. This horse has got to punch the ticket right now. I think he's going to have a first-class ticket to Louisville when it's all said and done. Now, there is a chance that Bob just wanted no part of California Chrome with this horse, but I just think he planned all along that this was what he had to do. He had a very minor little delay with a foot thing, which is never a good sign on the way to the Kentucky Derby, but he has obviously bounced back from that amazingly well. He had that 17 days without a work in early March. He's ready to rock and roll, and I'm just excited to see Gary Stevens, my favorite rider of all time, after the shoe, because he was my first favorite rider, to see him here, and I'm hoping he wins the race and hoping that it's just a good, good race. More importantly, that whoever wins this and get into the Kentucky Derby and win it. That's what I would. Whoever wins this, I want them to win the Kentucky Derby, because you just feel that kind of, you know, you get close to these horses, have the privilege of calling them.
Absolutely. And Frank, speaking of calling, obviously the Arkansas, the Oaklawn meet winds up this weekend. What's up for you next?
Next will be the California Authority of Racing Fairs. I call 5 out of the 6 fairs in Northern Cal. I start up in June. I do work for TVG as well, and so I'll be out there and having some fun in California, and I'll be missing Oaklawn. I mean, you know, it's going to be, right now we've got the big charge to finish it up, and then there's that huge letdown that starts on Sunday morning when we realize that it's all behind us until next January. But this is a very special place. I encourage all of your viewers, if you get a chance, to make a little visit out to Hot Springs sometime. It's a beautiful town, a lot of history here. Right now, if you look outside, it is gorgeous. The lake is phenomenal. And it's just a place that you will have fun. I promise you, you will not regret coming out to Hot Springs.
I'm behind you 100%. I got a sister who lives up in Fayetteville, and I did a road trip a couple of years ago and spent an afternoon down at Oaklawn, and it is an absolutely beautiful track. You have to put it on your list. And Frank, speaking of missing, we'll miss you. We absolutely appreciate your visits with us all season long. We sent Nancy out last week and said we appreciated her and her paddock commentary. We appreciate you and your pre-race prattle on the simulcast signal, and we absolutely enjoyed your visits here with us. So good luck on the weekend to you and everybody at Oaklawn and going forward with the summer as well.
And we appreciate you, Seth, and all the support, and I hope you have a couple of more scores before the meet closes.
That's the game plan. Thanks a lot.
Take care.
All right, Frank Miramonte from Oaklawn Park. A little before that, we had Dave Rodman from Pimlico and John DeSilva from RacingWithBruno.com. We're right up against the clock, so we'll wrap things up for this Thursday edition of Racing Across America. Enjoy the racing this afternoon. We'll see you tomorrow.
You're watching OTB TV, a service of Capital Off-Track Betting. We'll be right back.